music created so much excitement, tension, and terror as yours truly, an eight-year-old, would gather around the old Bakelite radio above the sink in the kitchen to listen to the air adventures, not of Biggles, but of Superman, in the 6 to 7 time slot on 3AW. And it's a great pleasure to have online Superman himself, Leonard Teale. Thank you for being with us tonight, Leonard. Good evening.
I'm not too sure that it's Superman himself, but
still. You'll always be Superman to me.
Leonard, when did you start recording Superman, which must go down in history as the most popular of all the children's serials?
Yes, it was very popular. It was extraordinarily popular. It was one of the... I'm not too sure that it wasn't the only one that went out of Australia. I remember hearing that... When it was on in Ceylon, in Colombo, there was a near riot because instead of putting on the next episode the following night, they repeated the same episode. So that gives you some idea of how popular it was. It also went to South Africa, I know that. So yes, it was extraordinarily popular.
But you're evading the question when you started doing it, Clark Kent.
No, I'm not evading it at all. I'm just filling it out a bit, Phil. No, it was 48. We did it from 1948 to 1953. And... that was 5 years. That's 1,040 episodes. And it was off air, I don't know what happened in Melbourne, but certainly at 2GB in Sydney. It was off air for a week, and then they started in 1953 playing it from the first episode again. And so it actually went on from 1948 to 1958.
Len, in the series Tarzan, there were many, many Tarzans, including Rod Taylor, and, well, the list is endless. But you were the only Superman, weren't you?
That's true, yep.
Had you been in the Argonauts prior to that, Len? I thought I read over the weekend where you'd been in that ABC show before John Hewitt.
Oh, yes, indeed. No, well, actually, I came into that in about 52 or 53. And after doing radio pretty consistently from 46 through to 56, I thought, as theatre had always been my first love and always will be, I thought that I'd been doing radio for too long, and so I decided in 1956, when the Elizabethan Theatre Trust started a touring company, which was called the Trust Players, I then gave up radio for about a year or more, and toured Australia with the Trust Players.
Len, let me just take you back to the very early days of Superman, when it all started, and when he actually left the planet Krypton and arrived on Earth, when he materialized to a father and son in a bus that is crashing down a precipice.
That sounds a bit like episode one.
It does indeed. Let's take you back, Leonard Teale, with Superman.
My dear, we've got the bus all to ourselves.
Yes, regular private car.
Where'd the driver go?
Oh, just over to the spring for a drink. It's a mighty hot day.
Well, he'd better hurry. We'll be late.
We can't start without the driver.
But we are starting. Look, Dad. The doors have closed. We're moving.
Right. The brakes. Something's happened to the brakes.
Oh, let's get out. Quick, open the doors.
No. Oh, they're jammed. They're quite shut.
Dad, we're going faster and faster. We're going downhill. And look, there's a tree falling right across the roadway.
Why, look. Look there in the sky.
What is it?
It's a man.
Why, he's flying.
It can't be. It's not possible.
Dad, he's coming straight at us. He's swooping down, coming through the roof. Dad!
Quick, grab hold of me.
No, put me down. Let me go.
Let me go.
One man to reach, Herb. Up through the top. Hold on. The bus. It's going to crash.
We got out of that just in time. The bus is a wreck, smashed into a million pieces.
Where are you going? What are you going to do to us?
What's happening? Put us down.
Don't be frightened. You're all right. I had to get you out of there in a hurry. Pulling you out through the roof was the only way. Now we're going down again. Down, down, down. There you are. Safe and sound in a field.
Well, I don't know what to say.
Oh, it's quite all right, Professor. Getting you and the boy out of that bus was nothing.
I can't believe it.
Who are you anyway? Where did you come from?
I have no name. I come from a world that no longer exists. Here in this world of yours, men would call me a Superman.
Oh, it's a dream. A wild, impossible dream.
The day it happened, we saw it. He flew down and took us under his arms.
And out of the bus, that's all. Nothing so strange about that.
You saved our lives, Jimmy's and mine. I don't understand even now, but I'm very grateful.
Are you, Professor?
I do doubt it.
Would you do something to prove it?
Would we? Anything at all?
Then make me a promise. Promise that you will never say anything about what has happened.
What? Don't you want people to know?
Not just yet. I want no one to know, except those I help. Will you promise?
Well, if you wish.
Good. Now, I want your advice.
You want advice from us?
You know this world. I'm a stranger. You know the people in it. And I have still to find them out.
You want to meet men, is that it?
Not meet them, Professor. Observe them. Study them. See them at their best and at their worst. Know which to help and when help is needed. If you can tell me
Dad,
that...
Dad, can we help him?
Well, yes, I think so. To mingle with people, to see men at the highest and the lowest. If that's what you want, well, let me think. How about a newspaper?
And that's how it all started for you, Leonard Teale as Superman.
Sounds wonderful, doesn't it?
You know, you've never lost that wonderful timbre in your voice, and I'm not sending you up now because it was evident in that serial.
Thank you very much indeed, Bruce. Yeah, it's lovely if you sort of just let your mind go and imagine everything that's happening. It's just so much better than television, isn't it?
Of course it is. Absolutely.
You want to. That, of course, was always the glory of radio. And incidentally, you... Just to answer about what happened with the Argonauts Club, what happened eventually was that I decided that I would, after having been with the Argonauts for about 3 or 4 years, that it was time that I got back to theatre, and so I left the Argonauts. I was Chris of the Argonauts, and at that point, Johnny Ewart came in to more or less take the character that I'd been playing in the Argonauts, and he was given the name of Jimmy. So
fair enough.
Indeed, I was with the Argonauts to begin with, and then Johnny Ewart took it over.
Well, Len, you know, it's very gracious of you to take our call and talk about Superman.
Well, it's an absolute pleasure, Philip. It's lovely to be talking to you both.
Well, we're talking about something that goes back to 1948. You know, you don't want to be typecast and only remembered as Superman, but...
I'd just like to be remembered as Leonard Teale.
Well, were the sound effects good in those days? They were almost ahead of their time.
Yeah, well, the sound effect where Superman actually jumps off the earth with after that well-known cry of, "This is a job for Superman! Up, up, and away!" And then the music used to come up, and there were about 3 or 4 different sound effects were in it to give that feeling. There was the music, and there was some wind, and there was other things as well that gave the feeling of actually jumping up off the earth and then flying into the sky. And the same with coming down again. There was a sort of a descending music, and there was music that started off fairly solidly and then sort of disappeared as he came down to earth again. And they were all there to excite people's imaginations.
But it's true what you said before, as you sit there, and I suppose you did listening on the telephone there, you could actually envisage that bus going down the cliff and the father and son being rescued. Now, to put that on television, it'd cost you millions.
That's right. And as a matter of fact, if it's your imagination, it's much more vivid than anything that you could see on television.
One aspect of early radio, and particularly the serials that fascinate me, and I'd love to know as much as I can about it, is the recording studios, how you all got together, how many episodes you put down in a day, all that sort of thing.
Right. Well, just take Superman, for instance. That was done in a morning. Four episodes were done in the morning. We'd get to 2GB at about 9 o'clock, and we would have a look at the script. Normally, you picked them up before so that you had a fair idea of what was happening, but sometimes the scripts just weren't available, so you saw them for the first time when you picked them up off the piano. There was always, do you remember? I don't know if there is where you are now, but there always used to be a piano.
Yes, and in those old early recording studios, always a sandpit for the cops running after the crook.
That's right, and there was always a whole lot of doors to open and shut. But always there was a piano, and the scripts would be on the piano, and you'd pick them up. They'll say, for the first episode, that'll be around about 9 o'clock or 5 past 9 after you've finished saying good morning to everybody. And then for 12 minutes, I think they ran, without the commercials, they ran about 12 minutes 30, 12 minutes 15, and you would do a read-through. Then the producer would come up, as the director used to be called in those days, and you'd go through it, his notes, where it wasn't happening the way he exactly saw it and where there would be effects coming in. We also used to, at the same time, have tentative cuts in the last 3 to 4 pages put in case it was running over time or running under time. And you'd be told what the tentative cuts were, and general remarks, and we'd have a bit of a 5-minute break, and then we would record it. And I guess we would have about 20 minutes to record 12 and a half minutes. If you finished on time, that was terrific, and you waited for people to come. Most of the time, it didn't quite work out like that. And sometimes people made a mistake, and of course, we were recording straight onto acetate. In those days, there wasn't any tape at that time, audio tape. You actually recorded them straight onto disc. As a matter of fact, out at HMV, they were still recording on wax in those days.
Goodness me.
And if anybody made a mistake, you had to go straight back to the beginning again.
Did you ever do any outside appearances, Leonard, dressed as Superman?
No, I never would, Bruce, and I tell you why, because as we've already spoken, it was a matter of imagination, and if you appeared as somebody in a crumpled J.C. Williamson's stockingette Superman suit, it just looked ridiculous, and it just destroyed people's imaginations. I wouldn't even allow myself to be photographed as Superman.
Well, I did in a very crumpled old Channel 9 suit that I that I found years later.
Yeah, look what it did to Bruce's career, Len.
Did you? To give you an idea, people, kids for instance, used to say to me, and this happened many more than one time, they would say to me, "Can you really fly?" And I was a bit stumped about that. And I don't know where it came from. It was, I suppose, a flash of inspiration, but it was something that I really believed. I said to this child, and I repeated it to other kids who asked me, I said, "Do you believe that I can fly?" And the kid said, "Oh, yeah." And I said, "Well, if you believe that I can fly, yeah, you're right. I can fly." And it, as we were speaking before, it's all in people's imaginations, radio. And anything like trying to give it an actual photograph or an appearance personally or whatever destroyed the imagination process, and so I would never do it.
Of course, children would have recognised your voice when you were shopping or in a bus or wherever, Len.
Well, when people used to introduce me as the voice of Superman.
In those days, you were Leonard Teale, weren't you?
For the first couple of years, yes, I was, Philip, but it started to... Well, I actually changed it when we were starting to get towards television, and also when I was doing more stage work. We used to do, or a lot of us used to do radio in the daytime, and then work with the amateur or the semi-professionals at night time. And it's one of those funny things, as far as public perception is concerned. If people can't pronounce your name, they're not going to use it. And if they don't use your name... if they don't use your name, they don't even use you.
Yeah, that's a point. We played the first episode of Superman last Sunday night, Leonard, and we had a call out of the blue from Elizabeth McDowell.
Oh, heavens, Betty McDowell.
And she said, "I played Lois Lane."
Yeah, what about that?
And it was lovely to speak to her again.
Yeah, what a lovely lady.
Were they a good cast?
Oh, they're a beautiful cast to work with.
Who was Perry White? Who was Jimmy Olsen, Leonard? Do you remember?
I had a number of Jimmy Olsons. I'm pretty sure that Johnny Hewitt, beautiful Johnny Hewitt that we were talking about before, I think he was one of them. And Johnny Million was. And for a long time it was a fellow called Ray Hartley, who had a very young voice. He was, I suppose, the same age as I was, but he had a very young voice. And I think there were... Trader Faulkner? Or Ron Faulkner, as we knew him in those days, who was now very successful in England, and who wrote one of the definitive biographies of Peter Finch. He was one of the Jimmy Olsons.
Leonard, before we go, I wonder if we could hear a transition from Clark Kent to Superman and then an up and away.
Oh, I think we might be able to do
that. Wonderful.
What can I think of? I wonder how we're going to get out of this. I think there is only one thing we can do. Excuse me a moment. I'll go out of this door here. Yes, they don't know, but this is a job for Superman. Out of these clothes and up. I can't do it. It's too...
Out the open window, 20 stories above the ground. In the wink of an eye, Clark Kent, cub reporter for the Daily Planet, becomes Superman, eagle of the sky, winging his way west over city and plain through the storm-swept night. But will he be in time? Can he checkmate the strange figure called the Wolf? Discover the plot? Save the Silver Clipper roaring toward Dayton at 90 miles an hour? Remember, don't miss the next installment of Superman. Superman is produced by Lawrence H. Sessel for Art Prancer. Superman is a copyright feature appearing in the Superman Comics magazine and in other comics magazines published by National Publications Incorporated.